Thank you, John. Thank you, Cindy. It's a pleasure to be here tonight. I've had a chance to speak at a number of different places over the years. Interestingly enough, I've never had to follow my daughter. So a special night tonight to do that. And I just want to really echo what Avery said. And I personally have learned from her in this area of athletes and mental health. And now as a head coach, have the opportunity to apply what I'm learning from her and how important that is in the discussion. Those were things we didn't talk about. I didn't come from that generation and there was that stigma. But to be able to have a daughter who has taught me by walking that road has been very helpful. And so it's never too late if you're a coach or a parent to always have those conversations. So thanks to Avery, and it's a pleasure to get to follow her. It's funny, over the last several months as a head coach in the NFL, this is the life I've been living with our team in these Zoom meetings, very much like this. You know, we got 90 guys on our roster. I see we have about 78 people online right now. So this feels like a team meeting. And I'm not going to lie to you. I'm going to bring some juice because I am fired up about what we're about to talk about. We're going to talk about the subject is the Bible and competition. And what we're going to see is that this might be one of the more practical Bible studies we could ever undertake. And in doing so, I've discovered a principle that's true not only in Bible study, but it was true in life as a football coach and a football player. And that's this: the things that are the most practical, right, oftentimes are centered on a core fundamental. Like, for example, in football, you know, we teach our play. We have long devoted periods of times where we drill players on simple fundamentals of footwork, plant, point, and drive, plant, point, and drive over and over again. Footwork drills, body position drills. Why do we do that? Just core fundamentals. Because in the game, it's always hard to predict all the things that could happen. We can predict some, but we want to equip them to practically apply these core fundamentals in every scenario that comes up. And in Bible study, you know, I found that to be very similar, true. What strong core theological truths, rather than finding strong theology being boring, I find strong theology empowering me like it does a football player to practice the core fundamentals to actually go out and live my life. So the objective tonight is to take one core theological principle that in some ways you might say it's deep, but it's really not. It's maybe the most practical thing that I've ever studied. And I want to share that with you guys tonight. I also want us to leave with a couple working definitions that have helped me. And these are just put in my own words, phrases that my wife and I have wrestled through, tried to live through for 25 years. And so these have stood the test of time, at least in the last 20 or 25 years or so. So I want to leave a couple of those things with you. And as John and Cindy said earlier, this is the Zoom world. So all ground rules are in effect. You know, there's the Q&A box. So as we go, whatever questions you might have, please submit them. I'm going to ask some questions. Some are going to be rhetorical. You know, some of them are going to be rhetorical, and then others, maybe you could put into the Q&A. So here we go. Let's get started. Let me share my screen with you to start. Excuse me one second here. Okay. Oh, we all shared there. I'm assuming we're shared. John, you'll tell me if I'm not, as long as I'm getting that right. Okay, so the first question that I want to ask you, a rhetorical question here. On a scale of 1 to 10, how competitive are you? How competitive are you on a scale of 1 to 10? Whether it's you're playing in the Super Bowl or you're playing cards with your family, where do you fit on that scale? I bet if we were to ask all the people on this call, we'd have a variety of different answers. anywhere on this scale, and that would be normal. But what's interesting, I want you to note that the scale was intentionally put 1 to 10 and not 0 to 10. And the reason is because the first premise, our first underlying premise here is going to be this, is that everybody has a competitive spirit. Now, some people are what we call hyper-competitive, and whether, no matter what they're playing, just got to win. We're trying as hard as they can to win at whatever it is that they're doing. Great. Other people like my father-in-law will say, we'll play cards, and he'll joke and say, hey, we're just playing for the fellowship. When of course we all know that it's a lot more about than the fellowship. And we all laugh about that. But there are people who use the phrase, I've heard people use the phrase, I don't have a competitive bone in my body. And I think it's fair to say over the years that I've looked at this, talked to people, studied this, it's just more a phrase to denote, they're just not obsessed with trying to win everything that they do when we play games. But there is the premise for sure that everyone has a competitive spirit. So that's the first premise. Okay, so let's talk about a definition if we're talking about competing. If you just look, now I'm going to later give a biblical definition to what it means to compete, but I just want to acknowledge that if you looked in most dictionaries, what you would see is something like this, an earnest struggle for superiority or victory. That's kind of the normal competition. Definition. And so we know that to be true, because when we look around in life, what we see is everywhere, whether it's sibling rivalries, where they're competing for the attention of their parents, whether it's spelling bees at school, whether it's athletic championships of all sorts, whether it's businesses competing for market share, whether it's countries competing in war. The fact is, this leads to our second premise, is that competition is everywhere. It's in every aspect of culture. It's in every facet of our lives. The reality is we just can't avoid competition. We cannot avoid competing. Hence, you can see why we could say whatever it is that the Bible says about competition is so practical. You take premise one, everybody has a competitive spirit. Premise two, competition is everywhere. We can't avoid it. So it probably will be very helpful and very practical if I can grow in my understanding of what the Bible says about competition. Because the reality is, if you're like me, over the years, you just struggle. We struggle with what to think about competing as Christians. We struggle how to respond after wins, after losses, how we prepare, how we encourage people, what we say. We struggle. And so let's just dig a little deeper into this. And start by asking ourselves, have you ever asked yourself the question of, why is it I want to win? Why is it that I want to win? And if we're to be honest, at least as a football coach, we don't just talk about winning many times. We talk about dominating, truth be told, when we want to go out to play a game. And we certainly acknowledge that there's playing a professional game where it's what you do for a living versus playing cards with your family. We'll talk about that in the end, hopefully in some of the Q&A. I'd like to get into the difference of that and theologically the difference between that. But at the outset, just say, why is it? Why is it that I feel like I want to win? Or why do you feel that? Why do you want to dominate? In other words, another way to rephrase the question might be, if we all have a competitive spirit, where does that come from? I mean, that's a good question to ask. Where does it come from? And so, when you start thinking about where it comes from, there's really, if we gave multiple choice, there would be three answers. Obviously, only one is correct. The first one, the two common errors, about as far as where this competitive spirit, where this urge to want to win, where does that come from? The first error would be Darwinism, the survival of the fittest mentality. Now, I'm not gonna take time to refute this right here because this is this is a forum on what the Bible says about competition. And the Bible doesn't teach Darwinism, but I'm just simply acknowledging that that is a answer out there that some people would ascribe to. If you want more on that, there's plenty of stuff written about that to refute that. But I'm just acknowledging at the outset, that's if there's multiple choice about where this comes from, that's going to be one of the suggested answers. The second one is, now let's get into what the Bible says. Let's at least dig into the Bible, because that's what we're talking about. And there are some, and many, in fact, who have experienced competition in quite a negative vein that would suggest that maybe because sin entered the world, and now because of sin, I'm selfish, I have selfish tendencies, and I want to, and a sinful, when I'm acting out of sin, I want to assert my own superiority over somebody else at their expense. That's what sin does. Sin puts ourselves before other people. Sin is very self-oriented, okay? So it might be fair, it might be logical to think, because of many experiences where we've had, where we felt that pain. We felt the pain of someone competing out of that motivation, out of a sinful motive. We've all been guilty of competing out of that motivation at times. And so that would be a second answer. That would be a choice on the multiple choice test for this question. But ultimately, we think about it, if we suggest that the root of the competitive spirit comes from a sinful, selfish tendency that we want to win all the time, if that's just selfishness, let's just trace that. Let's just follow that lead for a second. Okay, if the competitive spirit originates because of sin, then that means competition is evil. And then if competition is evil, but if it's everywhere and I can't avoid it, then as a Christian, I would have to disengage with the culture, because the Bible tells me to flee from sin, you know, don't participate in sinful behavior. And if competing is evil, then I have no choice but to withdraw from culture. And I think we all understand intuitively, and from our years in church and in Bibles, in Bible study and Bible reading, that we intuitively and spiritually know that, no, I don't think that's the answer. So then what do we do with that? And so what I would suggest is that, to go back to Genesis 3 is pretty good, but we really have to go back further into the Bible and go back to Genesis 1 if we really want to find the origin of the competitive spirit. And here, it's here, and this is actually before sin enters the world, which I found really interesting in my studies, you know, 20 years ago, investigating this. So when you look in Genesis 1, and we all know the verses, chapter 1, verse 26, right? You know, let us make man in our image. So Genesis chapter 1 is the story on creation. There's 5 days of creation. Everything is good. And then day 6, the human race, Adam and Eve, are created. And of course, there's something very unique about Adam and Eve, and it's very good. And of course, what's very good is that Adam and Eve and all of us are what? Made in the image of God. And so we've been given this great title, image of God. But what also comes along with a great title, just like today, if somebody has you get a title, there's a corresponding responsibility or a corresponding job description. And 2 verses later, we get to read, guess what? What our job description is. And when it says, and Genesis 1:28 is known as the dominion, doesn't that word sound familiar? Dominate, dominion, the dominion mandate. And that, of course, the dominion mandate tells us that we're to be fruitful, we're to multiply, we're to rule and reign over the earth, right? Under the authority and rule of God on his behalf. That's actually what our job description is as Christians, as anybody made in the image of God. So some of the language that I have found helpful over the years is, as a Christian, I've always thought, Adam and Eve were in the Garden of Eden, and their job description was to take the Garden of Eden and extend it to the ends of the earth. And so in a similar way, God gives each one of us, my wife Linda and I will talk about this a lot, we'll say, you know, God has put us in a small slice of the garden. Right now, that's in Indianapolis for us, in the community that we live in the city we live in the state we live in. He's also a slice of our garden is the sports world, the NFL world. That's the quote unquote neighborhood that we live in. That's our area of, that's our sphere of influence. That's the slice of the garden. Each one of us, every person on this call, has a slice of the garden that God has put us in. And like Adam and Eve, or we're to cultivate and to domesticate, and what we're to make something grow, to make the garden grow. So for example, as a husband in my home, if I'm going to exercise dominion, like if I said, hey, this person's a very domineering husband, that's not a very flattering term, because we think of domineering husband in sinful post-Genesis 3 terms of we've perverted it to use it for the wrong way for our own glory rather than for God's glory. But as a but from Genesis chapter 1, what I learned dominion is, the biblical is to unearth treasures, to make our home environment, to cultivate the environment in our home that my wife flourishes, that our children flourish, in our neighborhood that my neighbors, that we can encourage and bless and plant seeds and water seeds and act in a way that blesses. And as one professor, Richard Pratt, who I had, would say, unearth the treasures that are in the earth and unearth the treasures that are in other people. And so that was that's just been a very helpful metaphor for me to think through as a Christian, that we all have our own slice of the garden. At work, the locker room is part of that garden. My job as a coach is to cultivate, that's a garden. I need to plant seeds, I need to water it, I need to prune. Yeah, gardening includes pruning in parenting, in coaching, and being teammates. We tell our players, hey, we should be pruning, we should be correcting each other in the right spirit, right? We don't, when you go to prune something in the garden, you're not chopping it down, you're carefully pruning as a parent, as a coach. This is very helpful, very practical theology every day. I can go into work as a football coach and I'm thinking Genesis 1:28 every day. Here's a slice of the garden God has given me. What seeds am I going to plant? What fertilizer am I going to use? What pruning do I need to do today? In my home, in the locker room, on the football field, all very helpful. So that slice of the garden and unearthing treasures, very important concept. So there it is. I said I wanted to share one core fundamental theological principle that will apply in thousands and thousands of ways. It's the dominion mandate in 1:28, in Genesis 1:28. I don't know how many sermons we've heard on 1:28, probably not a lot. Genesis 1:28, I don't know. And how many as they apply to competition, probably not a lot. But it's my belief that it directly applies to competition, and competition is everywhere in almost every relationship that we're in. And so how practical is this to think that I'm gardening? And I'm not just gardening the area right here, but remember, Adam and Eve's mandate was to expand it, to make it grow. And of course, what we learn later in the Bible is that the Garden of Eden is a picture of the kingdom of God. And so in the New Testament, the version of the dominion mandate is the Great Commission, to go out into the world and make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. That's a direct outpouring. It's the New Testament version, if you will, of Genesis 1:28. Incredible how it ties a link all through the Old Testament covenants into the New Covenant, into the Great Commission, the expanding of the Garden. The Garden of Eden was what? It was the holy dwelling place of God. Remember, in Genesis 1, God was where? He was in the garden with Adam and Eve, right? It was the holy dwelling place of God. But then when sin entered the world, there was separation, right? Adam and Eve were banished and separation. But now to go out and have an opportunity and expand the kingdom in the same way that we are to do. So why is this so important to know? Why is this so important to know? I want to show you a two-minute video. I want to show you a two-minute video on why I think it's important. And maybe you've seen this video. This isn't the typical Christian video that you've seen. You might have seen this if you were ever YouTubing coaches motivational videos. This is one that I've shown our team multiple times. And I'd like to share this video with you.
You can write everything down if you want to. Be brave enough to write every one of your goals down. But I'm going to tell you something. Life's going to hit you in your mouth, and you got to do me a huge favor. Your why has to be greater than that knockdown. And I love it. Buster Douglas got knocked out. Nobody ever got knocked out by Mike Tyson and ever got back up. It was almost a 10 count. He was stumbling. They were 4, 3, 2, 1. Ding, ding, ding. Saved by the bell. He goes to his corner. The whole world is like, yep, that's it. Once he comes back out, that's it. Mike's going to just hammer him. And exactly that, Mike Tyson came out like, I got him. I got this kid up against the rope. Listen to me. Many of you right now, life's got you up against the rope. You can't give up. You can't give in. Listen to me. If it was easy, everybody would do it. And if life's got you backed up, I need you to do what Buster Douglas did. Buster Douglas started fighting back. World was shocked. Goliath has been knocked down. What happened? And they went to Buster Douglas and they asked Buster Douglas simply, like, what happened? And Buster Douglas said, listen to me, it's real simple. Before my mother died, she told the whole world that I was going to beat Mike Tyson. And 2 days before the fight, my mother died. Buster Douglas had a decision to make. When his mother died, he could die with his mother, or he made a decision, I can wake up and I can live for mom. And he knocked Mike Tyson out simply because his why was greater than that punch. His why was greater than defeat. His why was greater than his trial and his tribulation. And I'm telling you, if you don't know what your why is and your why isn't strong, you're going to get knocked out every single day.
You know, I asked you a couple minutes ago, have you ever asked yourself the question, why do I want to win? Why do I want to compete? And when I watch this video, although I've never thought about the video directly as much as I have in these moments leading up to this time tonight, applying to this that much more and making it even more deeper to understand. What they say in the video is, we better know what our why is when we get knocked to the canvas. And we all know life is awesome. It's challenging, but it's awesome. But we all know I'm at 58, I've been knocked to the canvas on more than one occasion. And I'm sure many on this call have as well. And if you haven't been knocked to the canvas yet, you will be knocked to the canvas. Nobody goes undefeated. And it's in those moments that, what is my why? And for me, personally, as an NFL coach, as a former NFL player, to have an understanding that my why is wired into God's calling on my life for the dominion mandate. He's given me this title. He's given us all this title, made in his image, right? That's a royal title. He's royalty, and we're made in his image. So we are his sons and his daughters, and we are called to go out and exercise, to be fruitful, to multiply. What does that mean? The first thing that comes to my mind about what that means to be fruitful, right, is the fruit of the Spirit, is the fruit of the Spirit, right? The love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, gentleness, self-control, right? All nine of the fruit of the Spirit, right? To expand that, to share that, so that that goes to the ends of the earth. That's my job as a coach. That's my job as a husband. That's my job as a dad, to share the fruit of the Spirit to the ends of the earth, right? And it's not just a spiritual thing. It is very spiritual, right? The fruit of the Spirit. But there's also a physical calling to this, that we are to go to the ends of the earth. We are to take this message. We are to, Adam and Eve, they weren't called just, they were kicked out of the garden and then said, hey, we messed up here. But now, right, here's a chance for redemption. Genesis 3:15 already said, it's already showing the hope that's there, is now go out and expand this to the ends of the earth. That's the opportunity. That why drives me every day. That's my job. It's not just a job. That's my calling. By God, Almighty God has called me to be his ambassador. I'm an ambassador of Almighty God to make the name of Jesus known to the ends of the earth, to let the fruit of the Spirit be evident in our lives in every aspect of what we do. That's a strong why. That's a strong biblical why. And so when I ask you, do you know why? Do you know why you want to win? I do. I know why I want to win, because it's for God's glory. Let me share this quote with you that I read many years ago that's really impacted me. And this is by a writer by the name of Henry Van Til. And he writes, the will to rule and to have power is increated. It's not demonic or satanic, but divine in origin. True men may misuse and abuse power after the entrance of sin into the world, but to say that all power corrupts and that absolute power corrupts absolutely is not wisdom, but that's folly and confusion. For power belongs to man by virtue of his creation as a cultural creature. He was made to function in the realm of power and to develop his power to its highest potency. For God, of course, and it's that last phrase that is the key to everything. For God, of course. So what this quote teaches me is not to shrink back, but to step forward courageously. We don't have all the answers. We're not as strong as we think, but I'm called to move forward in faith, to walk by faith, not by sight. And I will get knocked to the canvas. You will get knocked to the canvas, but the calling to keep pressing on, as Paul writes in Philippians 3, just keep pressing on, Philippians 3, 12 to 14, just keep pressing on. There's a picture, an illustration in my mind that I think of a lot when I think about the struggle and the journey. And it's, imagine this, imagine you went to a football game and you're sitting in a stadium and both teams come out. And to your surprise, they're all wearing the same uniform and the same helmet. And they're all standing on the same sideline. And the game starts. And now imagine you're not even sitting in the stands. Imagine you're on the field. How do you know whether you're in the stands or on the field, who's on what team? Well, the good thing is there's a football on the field. And one team is going to try to push that ball towards one goal, and the other team is going to try to push it to the other goal. And so you, even though we might be confused at first, we would, as the game went on, we would figure it out because of what goal the team is going towards. And in this particular illustration, of course, what goes through my mind is, though, when it comes to living my life and fulfilling this calling of exercising a dominion mandate or expanding the kingdom of God, it's those who are pressing forward to exalt the name of Christ, those who are pressing forward to expand the kingdom of God, the fruit of the Spirit, pushing those things forward out to the ends of the earth for God's glory, that's the one goal. Satan and the evil forces of this world would push against what is God ordained. And although we don't like to talk about it, it's uncomfortable, there is evil. And it is our job to press against that, to call it for what it is, to name it for what it is, and to take every thought captive, everything that holds itself against Christ and his kingdom, and take it captive. But we don't do that in anger or rage. We do that with the fruit of the Spirit, with love and joy and peace and patience and kindness. And we pour that out and we watch God melt and we watch God work in the way that only he can do it. As we do things from playing football or whatever sport it is that we're involved in, or even in our homes. Wrap up by saying this, that last phrase, for God, of course, it's pivotal, right? It's pivotal because to do everything for the glory of God is what it's all about. It's not for our own glory, but for his. But what does that mean in the realm of competition? What does it mean to play for the glory of God? Well, you know, we know, we've all, probably many of us remember the movie Chariots of Fire, and Eric Liddell, when he says, when I run, I feel God's pleasure. That's pretty close to home right there. I mean, that's, it's harder to say it much better than that. I'll just simply nuance it out just a little bit. But I first, just to tell you one short story that actually involves Avery, my daughter, who was just speaking to you moments ago. She's probably about 10 years old. And she's, as she said, a swimmer. And it was a really big travel meet down in, we were living in Charlotte, but the meet was in, she had qualified for a big meet and was in Jacksonville, Florida. And we get down there and it's her best event. It's the 50 freestyle. And she's over behind the blocks and I don't know exactly what happens, but somehow she gets pushed and she gets a pretty bad cut in her leg, on her thigh. And so she comes over and she's naturally, understandably, in tears, and she's in tears and it's bleeding. And so her mother and I are sitting there. And so, you know, I take a towel and I wipe it off and Linda's kind of helping her out and she's moments away from supposed to being able to swim. And it was a cut, it was bleeding, but it wasn't, I don't want you to think I'm the rough, tough football parent here. But it, I could tell it wasn't a life-threatening deal. And so here's what I said to Avery. I said, Avery, here's what I want you to think about, sweetheart. I want you to walk over there and get behind the blocks. And when it's your, because it's probably going to be in about 10 minutes. And I said, and when it's your turn to swim, I only want you to think about one thing. I want you to dive in. Don't worry what time you swim. Don't worry if you finish first. Don't worry if you finish last. Nobody cares, Avery. Just swim your best for the glory of God. Now, this wasn't the first time that Linda and I had talked to her about this. We had spent already, even at 10, years talking about this. Because in to try to counterbalance the simple do your best theology, because many parents rightfully and understandably tell their child, hey, just do your best, just do your best. But Linda and I always wanted to make it a point to say, do your best for the glory of God. Do your best for the glory of God. And you say, well, aren't you being a little bit crazy there? No, I really didn't think we were, because I don't want to assume that that's understood. Doing it for the glory of God is everything. And so what does that mean? It means diving in the water and just swimming your stroke to the glory of God with the abilities and the gifts he's given you. And you know what? It worked. What was ironic was it worked in. She swam the best race of her life. But you know why? You know why? Because the shackles were taken off. The shackles of trying to please her coach, the shackles of trying to please her parents, the shackles of trying to please her teammates. It's what was being talked about earlier. It actually freed her up to other motivations are real. Money is a motivator. Status is a motivator. Anybody who says those aren't real aren't living in the real world. But the greatest motivator, the one that surpasses them all, is love. And it's to the glory of God. And we've just experienced that over and over again in our life. So just to close, I want to show you, I just think it's important to show this last definition, these last slides. We talked about our definition of competing at the front end. So now the definition, the biblical definition, is more of a striving to complete the task to the glory of God. So whatever task it is that we find ourselves doing, we're doing that to the glory of God. And that really, this flows right out of Acts 20:24 when Luke is writing and Paul, quoting Paul here, however, I consider my life worth nothing to me. My only aim is to finish and complete the task the Lord Jesus has given me, the task of testifying to the good news of God's grace. So that's really what has been a helpful definition. So whether I was a player or a coach, I have a task to do. I got to be a good football coach. So the task of being a good football coach, I'm going to strive to complete that to the glory of God. Player the same way. And then just lastly here, just a brief word about winning. And then I know we'll be short on time, but maybe we can address this. What about winning? What does it mean? Does God care who wins? Is God involved in winning and losing? And I would simply say this, that the biblical definition of winning that I've embraced is conforming our character and actions or our performance to the will of our Father. And why is this our definition? Well, this is our definition because I believe this is the biblical definition. I believe when we look to the life of Christ, this is what Jesus did. We know that Jesus, he was the victor. He took on Satan, he took on sin, he took on death, and he won. And he was victorious. Thanks be to God for all of us so that we can have salvation. So Jesus won. How did he win? Because he lived a perfect and sinless life. He conformed his character and his actions. He went to the cross. He did what he was called to do. And so we get to see that in the face of Jesus. This is what winning meant to Jesus. This is what winning means to me. And so it looks different sometimes. Winning the scoreboard is important to me, but it's not as important as this. Winning on the scoreboard is a temporary reality. This is eternal. God uses the scoreboard. I use the scoreboard to grow in my relationship with God, to test my faith, to grow in my character and my actions, to make sure I'm trying to compete in a biblical way. But this has been a definition that has been really helpful. So I'll stop it there and then open it up, John, back to questions.
Thanks, Frank. You did bring the juice, as someone even said in the chat box, preach it, Frank. And you know, Frank, I really have always appreciated this about you. You live from your convictions, and just the way you shared about your experience with Avery and how you demonstrate over and over that this stuff really does matter, and how you've helped our audience, our attendees, to connect something as practical as competition to core theological ideas, that you really gave us a transcendent perspective that is grounded in theology. So thank you very much. And I want to get us started with the first question. How did competition actually impact your pastoral ministry? And then the reverse, how does pastoral ministry influence your coaching style?
How competition affected my pastoral ministry by understanding that my job was to unearth treasures as a football player, as a quarterback, rather than thinking my job is to see how many go out, rather than seeing how many touch, my job wasn't to go out and see how many touchdowns I could throw. My job was to go bring out the best in my teammates around me, execute the assignment I was given. Touchdown passes just resulted from that. So as a pastoral minister, it was my job to cultivate in the same way that you cultivate those things as a quarterback or a coach and other people, as a pastor, in an even deeper sense, trying to cultivate those fruit of the spirit in people's lives and families' lives. So very much impacted it. And now how it impacts me as a coach every day. I mean, I always tell my wife every day, there's not a day that goes by as a football coach that I don't look back on my time in seminary, or not the seminary is the answer, but it impacts everything I do.
Thanks. I love your convictions. It's amazing. You mentioned that Satan and his forces are alive and well, and oftentimes coaches might set up opponents as their enemy. Now, how, if your opponents are your neighbor, how do you help them flourish and stay competitive?
The way, again, we don't battle the same way the world battles. We battle with spiritual weapons, with the fruit of the spirit. We battle, you know, Jesus himself said in the Gospels, this is interesting to me. Jesus is the Prince of Peace, but yet Jesus himself says, I didn't come to bring peace, I came to bring division. In other words, there is a battle. And all I believe what I understand him to be saying there is a battle. There is a right and wrong. So when I have a neighbor or a teammate who might be of a different faith, my job isn't to judge them or condemn them. I'm not trying to, I'm just trying to live my life and let the light of Christ shine in me. The last thing I would ever want to be accused of is being self-righteous and being the guy who walks around thumping people over the head with the Bible. But how do we do that, but yet still have strong convictions? And about what we believe. And I think over the years, what I've experienced is just to have a sense of urgency, to be ready to share. But 1 Peter 3:15 also says, be ready to share when they ask. So sometimes as a football coach, I realize, or as a neighbor, my job as a football coach is to go in and to be a good football coach. But when I have one-on-one relationship time with, when I'm talking to a player about personal things and they ask, or we're talking about things, those things get shared in those moments because they're part of our lives.
That's well put and probably most helpful. Less words and more living it out. That's good.
Well, and again, I appreciate how you don't want to divorce your calling as a coach from your other responsibilities. There's a tendency to kind of bifurcate, to, you know, segregate other areas of our life and live really wholly in those areas, but not when it comes to ordinary life, or in this case, in sports. So good word. You also mentioned something I think is really important about how we are to resist evil and press against it. And a couple of questions come under this category. How do you see your Christian faith shaping how you're responding to the calls for racial justice that we've seen recently?
Yeah, they shape them to the core. And again, it goes back to being made, first and foremost, made to the image of God. Every person's been made in the image of God. And so that fact alone, they have inherent dignity and respect. Every person does, no matter of race, color, creed, faith, even those who are not of the Christian faith, and a person who's not of the Christian faith, that we're to love everybody. You know, we truly are to love everybody, and we're to love our enemies. So when it comes to racial justice, you know, as an organization, we've tried to be out in the front on this issue. And for me, that's meant listening and learning. For me, that has meant trying to understand the plight of the Black community that has been oppressed and hear their cries, to come alongside and be a voice, and to not be passive. And so what we're talking about here is expanding the kingdom of God and not being passive. And part of that, as a coach, as a Christian coach, you know, I have an opportunity to be a part of the answer and the solution of being part of an organization on how do we deal with social justice issues on our team. And as an opportunity as a Christian to bring a biblical worldview to the conversations that we have, which start with image of God, which I had a press conference talked about, you know, that everyone's made in the image of God. So those are very, and then those are very important discussions. They're hard discussions, but discussions that we need to have the courage to not be afraid to say what's wrong, to stand up for the oppressed. And in this case, it's the Black community. In this case, it's police brutality against the Black community, and to be a voice and not be passive.
So if we don't do that, then we're not being obedient to our calling as far as kingdom rulers.
Yeah. And I'm glad you gave me a second here, because this just hit me. Because one of the things that in this topic of theology of sport that I like to say is, in the game of life, unlike sports, there are no spectators. Everybody's a player. So to your point, John, that being passive, if you're passive on a football field, what's going to happen? You're going to get run over. By who? By both teams.
And the coach.
Yeah. And I thought when Avery and I were talking prior to this day, when we were visiting her and her husband, and when she made the point that she made, that parents and coaches who were passive and did no messaging of mental health had the same effect as those who had negative messaging. And I said to her, that's incredible. Because I felt guilty, because in my home, I was passive as far as any messages of mental health. I didn't talk about that with my children. You know, I tried to say positive things, but we never talked about mental. But it's the same thing when it comes to these areas of social justice. If we think that we're doing right by just not being and we think that we're not racist and we're passive, then we're wrong. If we're passive, we need to be, as we're saying and learning and growing, we need to be anti-racist. We need to not be passive. We need to take a stand and stop being afraid of saying the wrong thing and just trust that people will see our hearts if we're trying to do the right thing.
I mean, that goes back to your definition of competition as far as this againstness, right? In the best sense, we should be against those things that are misrepresenting or mistreating other people. So that's a great point. Cindy, you have a question?
You may have answered it, but oftentimes in Christian circles, you might hear the phrase that, well, Jesus is eternal. That's what matters. It's more important than sports. And so it's kind of a dualistic mentality. And you've mentioned it. I just want you to reiterate that all of life and whatever, however you want to do that, because it's not, it's everything we're doing.
Well, to your point, Cindy, so when I was in full-time ministry, as John mentioned, I was a seminary president. Then I pastored a church. And then I became a football coach. And when that happened, I felt guilty. I felt like was I quitting on God? Was I forsaking the ministry? And was I forsaking God? But it was a pastor friend of mine who helped counsel me on this issue to help me understand and remind me of the very thing that I was trying to preach as an athlete who was going out and talking about this, but I wasn't preaching it to myself enough, is that we tend to create a false dichotomy between the sacred and the secular world, that all work done to the glory of God is sacred. I didn't have to be in full-time ministry to be doing work to the glory of God. And so that I could step from a vocational full-time ministry role, a pastoral role, or a seminary president role, to being a football coach without forsaking my faith or without forsaking the gospel.
Great, well put. We're winding down here. John, we'll think of perhaps one more. Meanwhile, you wanted us to get back to the difference between recreational play and professional sports. Is there something you want to say about that? Or?
I'm glad you asked that. So, I guess we can finish with this one. I know probably running a little bit long here, but so I've had people ask me this question quite a bit. So like when my youngest daughter was, I remember when she was 9 and we'd go outside and we'd play basketball together. If I'm going to give my all to the glory of God and play my hardest, and I'm playing my 9-year-old, that means I'm going to block every shot she takes, dunk it on her every time, and it's not going to be a very fun game. And so, but why does she tell me when she was 9 years old, or even to this day if we play a game, Dad, don't let me win? Why do our children say that to us? Don't let me win. Well, because I think the answer is they want us to give our all. They don't want us to give 100% at work and then come home and give them 50%. So what I hope, now this is I won't get into the deep theological concept, but there's a perspective here that what helped me was learning to understand how when I played basketball with my daughter, I was still giving 100%. But the situation called for a different goal. So whether it's recreation, when I'm playing recreationally with my daughter, whether she's younger or it doesn't have to be about the scoreboard. It might be, hey, I need to teach her how to dribble with her left hand. Or this might be just to have a good time together, spend quality time together. Now, that's my goal. Now give 100% to that goal. Don't come home and give 50% to the kids. No, have a goal and give 100%. The goal changes based on the situation. That was very helpful for me. It was very helpful for me as a parent and helped me understand how that all works.
That's great. I could see where you're drawing from there. That was definitely John Frame and Ben Till. That's a great point. To wrap it up, one more question. A lot of Christian thinkers and leaders talk about the fact that humans are also created to play. How does created to compete relate to the impulse to play? And Do you think professional athletes can have a playful disposition?
Yes, I do. And I think it kind of connects to what we were just talking about, you know, that it does to the goal, you know, to the goal of understanding what's the outcome here, what's the desired outcome here, and that there is a time for recreation that doesn't have to be tied up into the, you know, into who wins and loses, who's going to win the championship, that there can be playful moments that are part of life, but it's part of that perspective of understanding and placing the emphasis on recreation as opposed to the winning and losing aspect of it at that time.